Good afternoon. Can I remind members that COVID-related measures are still in place and that face masks should be worn while moving around the chamber or indeed the wider Holyrood campus? The next item of business is portfolio questions, and on this occasion the portfolio is education and skills. If a member wishes to ask a supplementary question, they should press the request to speak button, so place an R on the chat function during the relevant question. And as ever, I would appeal to members and to ministers for brief questions and brief responses. And question number one comes from Eleanor Whittam, who joins us remotely.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what plans it has to extend financial support for outdoor clothing to early learning and childcare settings.
Minister Claire Hawhey.
Childcare providers have worked creatively over the pandemic to increase opportunities for outdoor learning. As evidence shows, the risk of transmission is reduced outdoors. And to support this, in December 2020, we launched a £1 million outdoor clothing fund for providers of funded early learning and childcare as part of our wider winter support package. The fund was used to buy outdoor winter clothing for children who needed it most. 1,040 childcare providers successfully bid for the funding through the fund, and children continue to benefit from the clothing this year. We continue to work closely with the childcare sector to monitor the impacts of the pandemic and to keep the need for further financial support under review.
Thank you. Eleanor Whittam.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Can she outline what steps are being taken to increase child access to outdoor play?
Minister.
So we are supporting the growth of outdoor learning and practitioner confidence in this area in a number of ways. We funded a virtual nature school programme during the pandemic, and this supported more than 2,000 practitioners and 40,000 children and families to have quality outdoor experiences. We funded Inspiring Scotland through the ELC expansion to help increase outdoor play and learning activities. And we continue to add to our Out to Play practitioner guidance series. The National Practice Guidance, Realising the Ambition, is also supporting practitioners to deliver more outdoor play. And going forwards, we will be working with practitioners to develop strong communities of practice.
Thank you. Supplementary, Colin Smith, who also joins us remotely.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Minister will know that pupils are not just in need of warm clothing outdoors at the moment, but frankly are freezing indoors just now in classrooms. So could the Minister tell us what additional financial help is being made available for parents to keep their children warm inside the school, because teachers are having to open windows in the middle of winter in place of proper classroom ventilation?
Minister.
Well, as Mr Smith will be aware, the Scottish Government provide school clothing grants to school-aged children, and that has increased over the years, and we will continue to support families who need our assistance to provide adequate school clothing.
Thank you. Question number two, Colette Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how many pupils in East Kilbride will be included in the rollout of free school breakfasts and the expansion of free school lunches.
Cabinet Secretary, who joins us remotely.
Free school meals and providing breakfast to all primary school pupils during the course of this parliamentary term. Once free school meals are expanded to include P6 and 7, the total number of pupils being offered free school lunches in Scotland will be around 390,000, based on most recent pupil census figures. We have already expanded free school meals universally to primary 4 and 5 pupils from January this year. I can't provide specific information on the number of pupils who will be eligible for these important benefits in East Kilbride, where there are currently 17,627 pupils in primary 1 to 5 and special schools in South Lanarkshire, and just over 25,000 pupils in primary and special schools in South Lanarkshire who would benefit from free school meals and breakfast expansion in due course.
Colette Stevenson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Can she outline how the Scottish Government will work with local authorities and organisations like Magic Breakfast to deliver this? And what benefits will this provision have to pupils in terms of nutrition and wellbeing?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the Scottish Government does work closely with our local authority partners on an ongoing basis to support them as they deliver food and drink in schools, and we will continue to do so, of course, as universal school meal provision is expanded. All food and drink in schools, including lunch and breakfast, must meet the school food and drink regulations, which are designed to ensure children and young people are provided with balanced and nutritious food and drink to support their growth and development. As they deliver school meals, local authorities can, of course, partner with organisations such as Magic Breakfast in the members' constituency if they choose to do so, taking account of local needs and priorities.
Thank you. Question number 3, Bob Doris.
To ask the Scottish Government what assessment is made of how access to further education by students from the most deprived areas has been impacted by COVID-19.
Minister Jamie Hepburn.
I'm clear that every young person should have an equal chance of success, no matter their background or circumstance. SFC college data published this week shows that 32.2% of credits on FE courses at colleges in 2021 were provided to learners from the 20% most deprived areas in Scotland. HESA University student statistics also published this week show we have a record high 16.7% of full-time first degree entrants to university coming from those same areas in 2021, maintaining the position from the year before of exceeding our interim target of 16% by 2021. The financial support provided to students over the course of the pandemic has been substantial, with now over £96 million provided via hardship funding, digital access, mental health support and for student associations.
Bob Doris.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Minister, Glasgow Kelvin College in my constituency informed me that over the last 2 years, COVID-19 has had a disproportionate impact on part-time, community-based and non-advanced further education programmes that the college would be, normally be involved in, most pronounced for learners from SIMD 20 postcodes. Will the Minister ensure that is taken into account when allocating resources for the coming year to ensure those most impacted by COVID-19 from our most deprived communities can access educational pathways they require to help close attainment gaps? And will he accept my invite to visit Glasgow Kelvin College to discuss these challenges further?
Minister.
Well, let me first of all say I'll of course be happy to accept my friend Bob Doris's invitation. I can say I've always been very impressed by Kelvin College and the work they undertake, particularly in the area of apprenticeships, and indeed the work that Bob Doris was mentioning, their community learning and development work. In terms of the funding for the forthcoming year, SFC is currently identifying the best split of available resources for the coming financial year, taking into account our priorities and the needs of the sector, with a view to providing indicative institution allocations in March. My clear expectation is that those allocations should be responsive to our social and economic needs, but of course also to community requirements, and in that regard the issues that Mr Doris has raised are very pertinent.
And a brief supplementary from James Dornan, who joins us remotely.
Thank you, Convener. Does the Minister share my concern that the most recent statistics show we've seen a continued drop in the number of EU students coming to study here in Scotland?
Did the Minister catch that question?
I think Mr Dornan might have been referring to the drop in the number of EU students coming to Glasgow, Scotland to study. The impact of Brexit has, of course, magnified by the pandemic, has contributed to a significant drop in EU applicants. That is, I think, very regrettable. Of course, we have world-leading institutions here. We very much value the contribution of EU students they make to our economy, to our culture and to our academic institutions. They enrich our campus life, and I hope we can still welcome many in future to our world-leading institutions.
Thank you, Minister. I'm not sure, I think all of that is true, but I'm not sure they come from the most deprived areas impacted by COVID. But nevertheless, question number 4 comes from Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to ask the Scottish Government what assistance Skills Development Scotland can provide to OVO Energy employees in Perthshire South and Kinrossshire who may be facing redundancy.
Minister Jamie Hepburn.
We have already offered support to OVO through our Partnership Action for Continuing Employment initiative for employees who may be affected by redundancy. Skills Development Scotland leads the delivery of PACE support on behalf of the Scottish Government. SDS PACE representatives met with OVO on the 20th of January to discuss the type of support that might be available, and PACE representatives maintain contact with OVO during this time to progress the planning of PACE support.
Jim Fairley.
I thank the Minister for his answer. And you may be aware that I met with senior Oval management last week, and I have to say that John Swinney, Pete Wishart and myself left with more questions than we went into the meeting with. So it's somewhat reassuring to hear, despite the lack of assurance from Oval, that the Scottish Government will be able to give some kind of assistance. But can the Minister tell me what support the Scottish Government might be able to provide to ensure that facilities such as Oval Office in Perth can continue to be used as major employment hubs or training hubs?
Minister.
Well, of course, this is an issue that impacts my own constituency as well. President Officer, there are some 600 jobs under threat in Cumbernauld. Of course, Ivan McKee is rightly leading this as the Business Minister, but I can say from my own experience as the previous Business Minister, Scottish Enterprise would, of course, be very happy to have any conversations around how that could be taken forward. And for my own part, I would very much expect SDS to continue to play its part in discussion of these matters and how they can support Ivan McKee in responding to the types of point that Jim Fairley has raised.
Thank you. And supplementary, Murdo Fraser.
Thank you. My colleague Liz Smith and I also met OVO on Friday and impressed on them the need to continue supporting workers. As Jim Fairley said, there will be a large office building left lying empty in Perth as a consequence of this decision. The previous Scottish Executive had a programme of relocating public sector jobs out of Edinburgh to different parts of the country. Is that something the current Scottish Government could be considering?
Minister.
Well, of course, that is something that we have done. The Social Security Agency was located in Dundee for that very purpose. I think what we would do in this instance, of course, is we would seek to engage with OVO, as I've laid out, understand their plans, engage with them to see how we can support the workforce, and then these other matters could be part of a wider consideration.
Thank you. Question number 5, Emma Harper.
To ask the Scottish Government how it is supporting Skills Development Scotland to engage with the agriculture and rural sector to promote opportunities and apprenticeships for young people as a positive career destination.
Minister Jamie Hepburn.
The Skills Action Plan for Rural Scotland is driven forward a partnership approach, developing skills and talent needed to make sure that Scotland's rural economy and communities continue to flourish and grow. The plan recognises that rural areas face particular skills challenges and supports activities to address them in particular. The Scottish Government provides funding and direction to Skills Development Scotland to ensure that it delivers against our priorities. And 21-22 priorities included driving the implementation of the plan by supporting the development of the employer's toolkit for the agricultural sector and commencing planning for a review of land-based apprenticeships to ensure they deliver the skills for the sector needs now and into the future.
Emma Harper.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Through engagement with local manufacturing and agricultural businesses, I've had feedback that Skills Development Scotland can be sometimes challenging to engage with on manufacturing and agricultural career opportunities, and these are vitally important sectors in our rural areas. Can the Minister outline what action the Scottish Government, or what further action the Government can take to support STS to promote apprenticeships in agriculture and rural skills, particularly given their importance to Scotland's economy and in our fight against the climate emergency?
Minister.
Well, let me first of all say if there are any specific challenges that Ms Harper wants to raise to me, I'll take that away and pursue that with Skills Development Scotland. But my clear expectation is that they do engage, and in relation to the challenges around ensuring the rural Scotland is supported, I have to say right now they're a member of the Skills for Farming group. They're engaging with the National Farmers Union Conference in February. They're sponsoring the Land for Aquaculture and Land-Based Awards in March. They've updated the My World of Work website, which has been supported by Skills for Farming group as part of Scottish Apprenticeship Week. They are taking an advertorial in the Scottish Farmer newspaper. They contributed towards the Skills Action Plan for Rural Scotland that I mentioned, and they produced the Rural Employers Toolkit that I mentioned as well. So there is significant engagement, and more fundamentally, President Officer, I would expect them to deliver as well. And in that regard, in terms of the number of apprenticeships we see in Scotland, broadly speaking, the number of apprentices starting in the last year, 2021, were broadly consistent with the population share in rural communities. For example, in Dumfries and Galloway, we see 2.8% of the they constitute 2.8% of the Scottish population, but 3% of modern apprenticeship starts in the Scottish Borders, 2.1% of the population aged over 16, but 2.3% of apprenticeship starts. So I think Skills Development Scotland are doing a a fairly good job delivering for rural Scotland.
Thank you. A brief supplementary from Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Rural depopulation is an issue, and we need to ensure that we've got vibrant communities across Scotland to keep new entrants alive in farming. Would the Minister agree that the Scottish Government should put a greater emphasis on food and farming in schools and further and higher education settings? And may I ask when the Minister last met the Royal Highland Education Trust so that we can discuss the importance of education to meet the skills that are needed to manage the countryside, produce good food and indeed tackle rural depopulation?
Minister.
Well, I can say to Ms Hamilton, I have had the pleasure of meeting with the Trust in the past. I've engaged with the Royal Highland Show. When that's able to be up and running again, I'll be very happy to do so again. We place considerable emphasis on supporting the sectors that Ms Hamilton has referred to, and would also be expecting our developing young workforce regional groups to be engaging with those sectors so that young people are aware of the great opportunities they have in those particular sectors.
Thank you. Question number six, Pam Gothel.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the teacher recruitment drive.
Cabinet Secretary.
Teacher numbers have increased for 6 years in a row, and there are now more teachers than at any time since 2008. There are now over 2,000 more teachers than before the start of the pandemic in 2019. We have provided £240 million of additional investment over two financial years to support this, and a further £145.5 million of permanent funding from April this year to support the sustained employment of these teachers. A new phase of our teacher recruitment campaign is underway. We're continuing to offer bursaries for career changers to move into STEM teaching, and we have increased initial teacher education targets for student intakes this year.
Pam Gothel.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. In a recent EIS member survey, 17.8% of respondents said that violence and abuse from pupils was the greatest cause of stress in the past 12 months. In my region, West Dunbartonshire, pupils at the secondary school went so far as to create faking dating profiles to humiliate teachers. Can I therefore ask the Cabinet Secretary, does she agree that the long-term retention of teachers will be more difficult if problems like this will continue? And what action is the Government taking to permanently end this kind of abuse?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Pam Gothel for raising this very important point. Absolutely, the teacher wellbeing is critical at all times, but I think particularly given the most challenging circumstances which teachers and support staff have been working on during the pandemic. Behaviour such as abuse or attacks on teachers and support staff is, of course, completely unacceptable under any circumstances, and it is of course, very important that schools and local authorities have strict processes in place to be able to deal with measures and certain circumstances when they happen. If there is a requirement for further support from either government or from Education Scotland, for example, to support councils and indeed schools directly as they target that abuse, then we would of course stand ready to give that support.
Thank you. I've got a number of supplementaries. I'd hope to get them all in, but they'd need to be brief, as well as the responses. Firstly, Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary has talked about the increasing number of teachers. Could the Cabinet Secretary confirm how many of these new posts will require applicants to have additional support qualifications or experience?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, of course, as the member knows, all teachers are trained and able to deal with pupils and support pupils with additional support needs. He will, of course, also be aware of the proposal and assurance that we have within the agreement with the Scottish Greens to ensure that we are looking at what more we can do to insist that teachers are able and supported to be able to deal with these matters. And I'll be gladly keep the member and indeed Parliament updated on this as we move forward with that work with our colleagues in the Scottish Greens.
Thank you. Willie Rennie.
I remain very concerned about the large number of unemployed teachers as well as those on casual short-term contracts. The last time I asked the Cabinet Secretary how many there were in the country, she didn't have a clue. If the government doesn't know the scale of the problem, how are we going to fix that problem? So does she have an answer yet?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as Mr Rennie well knows, we have workforce planning that goes on both within the Scottish Government and within local government to be able to assure that we have sufficient teachers in place to be able to assist our schools as they do that workforce planning within separate schools. We're, of course, working on that with local authority partners. As I've said already in my original answer, the Scottish Government has committed additional funding to ensure that the number of teachers on permanent contracts is something which is looked at exceptionally seriously. The funding from local government has now been baselined. There is no need for teachers to be on temporary contracts if they were previously on a temporary contract through the COVID funding that we had in place. Of course, this is a matter for local authorities as the recruiter and retainer of teachers.
And a final brief supplementary from Cocab Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to ask the Scottish Government what impact increased investment in teacher recruitment is having on pupil-teacher ratios.
As briefly as possible, Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as I said in my original answer, I think there are more teachers now than at any time since 2008, and the ratio of pupils to teachers is at its lowest since 2009.
Thank you. Question number 7 comes from Colin Smith, again, who joins us remotely.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what resources will be provided to ensure that all students have equitable access to revision support ahead of any exams.
Cabinet Secretary.
Schools are best placed to support learners who have experienced disruption to catch up on their learning and have the best chance to demonstrate their potential. But to complement and enhance the school-based supports, Education Scotland has put in place a package of support through the National E-Learning Offer. Through GLOW, our national schools intranet, senior phase learners can access eSchool supported study, webinars and resources. Senior phase Easter study support programme, extremely popular last year, will be repeated this year, offering live webinars covering over 60 courses at a range of levels from National 4 to Advanced Higher. All learners also have access to over 1,850 West Online School videos to support senior phase learning.
Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We know the disruption to students' education continues with ongoing significant absent levels amongst pupils and school staff. Some parents will be able to afford additional tutoring for their children ahead of the exams, but the poorest won't. So does the Cabinet Secretary accept that we need to urgently escalate support for students sitting SQA exams this year, including providing in schools additional resources for targeted learning support during the Easter holidays ahead of forthcoming exams?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I very much agree with the premise of Mr Smith's question. That's exactly why the Scottish Government is working with our colleagues in local government exactly on the issue of Easter support. We are currently working with COSLA, and that is going through the usual COSLA processes. Once it has gone through that process, we will, of course, then be able to make a further announcement on that, because I quite agree that we need to ensure that support is there, particularly for those that have had a severe disruption this year. And that's why I'm delighted that we are working with COSLA, and I would hope to make an announcement on that very soon once it's gone through the usual COSLA processes.
Thank you. And question number 8, Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what plans it has to make a student housing strategy which includes rent controls and student tenancy rights for every student in Scotland.
Minister Jamie Hepburn.
Although the Scottish Government has no direct role in the provision of student accommodation nor with capacity within the private rental market, we are aware of the pressures relating to these. That's why we are committed to bringing forward a student accommodation strategy for Scotland, which in part will be informed by a review of purpose-built student accommodation. We will look to develop and incorporate the student accommodation strategy alongside and within the rented sector strategy. This will include issues such as supply, affordability and wider planning and regulatory issues.
Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you. With a 34% rent hike over the last 3 years, does the Minister agree with the National Union of Students that the student housing system in Scotland is fundamentally broken and that the disconnect between student income and rent levels poses an extreme and immediate threat to access and participation in education? Will the Scottish Government commit to urgently creating a student housing strategy which includes rent controls end student tenancy right for every student in Scotland?
Minister.
Well, I have been able to meet with the National Union of Students to discuss these issues. I understand the concerns that they have. They have been particularly exacerbated in the last year by events taking place which have put pressure on housing supply. The issues that Mr Chowdhury raised will be fully considered as part of the review that we undertake in terms of purpose-built student accommodation, but also as part of that student accommodation strategy that we are committed to taking forward. And if Ms Chowdhury would like to provide me any information, engage with me on that matter, I'd be very happy to discuss that further with them.
Thank you very much indeed, Minister. That concludes portfolio questions. There'll be a brief pause before we move to the next item of business.